Hello and welcome to the Friday, July 24th edition of the TV on Basketball Podcast with your host, TV. Again, I am back again with another podcast. We had some great episodes this week on Monday with Critical Condition Sports and on Wednesday with Ethan from Ethan and Mike. We had some great podcasts, but, you know, sometimes you got to do it alone. And today, we have some things to talk about, especially with the NBA being back in just 6 days. Yes, the NBA is back in 6 days. I'm extremely excited for it. I've been watching some of the, you know, the scrimmage games and stuff. So just anything to get basketball, like just seeing my feet full of basketball stuff again, just makes me happy to know that, look, the NBA season is back. And, you know, just as a sports fan, it's awesome to be where we are right now. And on today's podcast, we're going to be doing things a little bit different. We're going to be talking about, you know, all 22 teams are in the bubble. But I know that I can ramble on a lot and that these things can go on quite a bit of a tangent. So today, which we're going to do things differently. What we're going to do is that we're going to talk about each team in under a minute. I'm going to give myself a 1 minute timer. We're going to have a little timer. I believe I'll have it. I'll try to do it bottom right of the screen right over here. And we're going to see, I'm going to talk about each team for about a minute. And then halfway through, after I've done 11 teams, we're going to be talking about like a one particular story that has taken the NBA by storm. And then we're going to go back and finish the rest of the team. So it's a great podcast line for you. Hopefully I don't ramble on as much. That's what the point of the timer is. And just keep things short and concise. I'm just going to basically talk about how kind of my expectations for each team that is in the NBA Orlando bubble right now. And yeah, there's just a lot of things to talk about in today's podcast. But before we get into the actual talking, I still have to do my, plugging. So please, if you're watching this on YouTube right here, right now, and you see my beautiful face, please hit that like button. Please hit that subscribe button and also share with your friends. That'd be very much appreciated. If you were listening to it on the good old podcast networks on Apple Podcasts, please leave it a 5-star review. Subscribe, share with your friends as well. If you're on Podbean, please follow, like, and download if possible. And remember, we're also on Spotify and Anchor, so we're almost everywhere. Again, you guys have no excuse to not show some love. So, but yeah, either way, I'm not asking for too much, but please try to show some love. I really appreciate y'all. And of course, remember at TV on Basketball for on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram for updates on the podcast and for other content. So yeah, that after that very long, you know, session of just plugging away, let's get right into this episode. And the way I'm going to be doing this is I'm going to be talking about kind of the bottom, like, 11 teams for now, like the kind of going, like, in terms of overall record. We're not going to go by conference. We're not going to and by stance and all that. I'm just going to go from the worst team in the bubble to the best team in the bubble record-wise right now, not, like, conferences or anything. So, yeah, that's the way we're going to be doing it. And without further ado, let us get started. The timer is going to start in 3, 2, 1, and here we go. The first team I want to talk about is the Washington Wizards. And again, these are just one of the teams that kind of baffle me that they're even in the playoffs, like in the first place, like in not the playoffs, but the just in the bubble in the first place, because they're a ways away from the number 8 seed Orlando Magic. And at the same time, I just think that the NBA felt like because they're sending 6 West teams to the bubble, they're going to need to have at least one East team. And the Wizards kind of are the default choice. But the problem is, like, now that Davis Bertans is opt out of the bubble, now that Bradley Beal is not going to play, what's the point? They already had a slim chance going into the bubble. Now, with their two best players, and don't forget John Wall is not playing here either, they have no chance at all. And I guess the only thing that these 8 games can do is just give them a sense of clarity of where they want to go next in the direction of their franchise. We're going to see a lot more of Hachimura, Bonga, Thomas Bryant, and hopefully they can see what they can use for next season going forward. Next team we're going to be looking at is the Phoenix Suns. And again, kind of like the Washington Wizards, I felt like they're just another, like, team. Like, they really wanted to, like, get these, like, minimums in terms of, like, TV numbers and stuff like that for some of these teams. And the Phoenix Suns kind of got shoved into there. And the thing about the Phoenix Suns is, like, kind of like the Wizards, like, why are they here? Like, it's been another disappointing season for the Suns. And how many times do we have to say that year in and year out? Throughout Devin Booker's career, I don't think they've gone near a playoff spot, which is absolutely baffling for one of the premier two guards in the league, if you really think about it. And with Kelly Oubre out for like out because of injury, like they're already like ways away from the 18th, and now it just becomes honestly nearly impossible. I guess a good thing that they came out of the season is like Devin Booker, another great year. DeAndre Ayton took another good step, but when are we gonna start making excuses and see like them actually put a product out on the floor? They just have to see who they have this in this bubble and just move forward with that. Boom. We move on to the next team. We're gonna be talking about the San Antonio Spurs. And sadly, I just think this is gonna be the end of their playoff streak that, you know, the playoff streak that basically lasted for over two decades. Two decades long, they've made the playoffs. They never missed the playoffs. And this year, these unfortunate circumstances, they're just not going to make it. And I honestly would give them a slim chance, not a big chance, but a slim chance, if LaMarcus Aldridge was around and, you know, a healthy roster, especially like DeJounte Murray, DeMar DeRozan, they have some ballers there. But without LaMarcus Aldridge basically being their best or second best player, that could be debated. But without that, they have no chance. But the really question is, like, are they really going to bounce back for next year with Popovich almost retiring and stuff like that? Like, where do they go from here? I just think that they have a really great organization. And because of, like, their personnel management, you know, coaching, whatever, scouting, I just think that they will be able to move forward and continue the Spurs way. Maybe not next year, but maybe the year after. We then move on to the next team, and that is the Sacramento Kings. And kind of, like, mixed in this whole bubble, like, I just think people don't realize that the Kings are injured. And they're not really talking about it that much because they're like, oh, it's great. You know, zero COVID cases right now, which is great to see basketball on the court. But people are not talking about, like, the Kings are missing some big-time players. De'Aaron Fox, like I mentioned in, an episode last week, he's not going to be, like, is going to be reevaluated, I think, in the next few days. Marvin Bagley got injured in practice, and he's not even going to be able to play in the bubble. And again, same with the Spurs, Suns, and Wizards. Like, they're just kind of a filler team. I just don't think, like, they had a chance anyways. And now, like, without the health of those guys, it gives them, like, really no chance at all. And, you know, they're already looking towards next year. I mean, I'm going to give this team a few more years to kind of figure things out, but I could see them being in the same position as the Suns if they don't, like, take advantage of what they have. Next thing we're going to go to is the New Orleans Pelicans. And this is the AC that everyone is very intrigued with, you know. The fact that we're seeing Zion Williamson play again is a big W. He is box office. He is money. And we're just excited to, like, just see that type of, like, team play. And the biggest thing I can just talk about them is, like, this is going to be a fun team to watch. Lonzo Ball, Brandon Ingram, Zion Williamson. They're just going to be an entertaining watch. Even if they don't make the playoffs, like, I think, like, they may or may not make the playoffs. It's still, like, a small chance that may not happen. Like, I just think that they're just going to be fun. Even for eight games, seeing Zion Williamson, Brandon Ingram play, that's a big-time W. And, again, at least, like, with this team, like, you could tell that you at least had, like, a small slim of a chance. And even if they, like, say they do make the playoffs, I don't think they could take, like, one game off the Lakers. Why not? Just because of, like, they can, like, kind of catch them by surprise. So I think this team's going to be an entertaining team to watch watching in this bubble and just get to see more Zion. Boom. We're going to go on to the next team, and that is the Portland Trail Blazers. And I think pundits, a lot of, you know, just people like on Twitter and stuff, they kind of underestimate this team because I think a lot of fans want to see either a John Morant playoff appearance or a Zion Williamson playoff appearance. But they forget about this team that made the Western Conference Finals last year in the Portland Trail Blazers. And, you know, they have the best player out of all those three teams and Damian Lillard. And I think they benefited most coming out of this bubble because they were injured all season long. And now, because of this hiatus, Yusuf Nurkic is back, who hasn't played all year. Same thing with Zach Collins, another big man piece. Like, they didn't have a big man rotation. Now they have a pretty deep one, in my opinion. And like I said, these guys have the experience. They have the best player. I don't see why not they can make it. I mean, the Pelicans and Magic and Grizzlies would be more fun, but this is the team that everyone should be watching. Boom. Next team we're going to be talking about is the Orlando Magic. And the thing about these bottom East teams, like, if you go from seed 7 to 9, it's just dead. It's just completely dead. And the Magic are just one of those teams. Like, they didn't have, like, much improvement from last season. They gave Nikola Vucevic that big-time contract, and it hasn't really paid off. I mean, sure, they made the playoffs again, but at the same time, like, you know, what is there to grow after this? Like, Aaron Gordon has not taken the steps that we thought he was going to take. Like, 14 points a game this year. I think that's honestly a disappointing season for Aaron Gordon, especially for the expectations that we thought he was going to have going forward. And especially the way he kind of ended last season, he thought maybe it's a good stepping stone. You know, they took a game off the NBA champion Raptors. Maybe that there's something they can build off that. They haven't really, and I just think there's like a lot of big question marks with the team, especially with like their so many signs on their roster. They just have to figure this thing out, and they're definitely going to be looking more forward to next season. Boom. Next, we're going to be going to the Brooklyn Nets. And the Brooklyn Nets here, you know, a healthy Brooklyn Nets team, extremely interesting. Obviously, KD, Kyrie, DeAndre, Torian Prince, give them the whole roster. They're a top five team in the East, for sure. But they're not healthy, and that is just a plain fact of it. And, you know, having seen, like, the preseason or the scrimmage games so far, like, they're going to be, like, easy picking for the team. I mean, Caris LeVert in his first game as the number one guy, 5 for 16, I believe only 10 or 12 points, didn't look good. And they got absolutely demolished by Zion-less Pelicans team. And the thing about the Nets, like, you know, again, like I said about these other East teams, it's just going to be dead. Like, whoever, like, 7-8 is going to be, they're going to be absolutely demolished by the number one or two seed. And that's a plain fact. And I've talked about the Nets enough. So, yeah, it's just not going to be a fun time for them. Next team we're going to be talking about is the Memphis Grizzlies. And this is the team I want to have come in the 8th seed in the West, because I am impressed, like, highly impressed with John Morant's production this year. And I think they're just a great story. Like, Mike Conley leaves. Marcus August traded the last year. Zebo had to leave a few years back. Like, this is a transition to a more fun, a more energetic Grizzlies era. And I think John Morant is the perfect guy to lead that. I mean, he has the charisma. He has the energy. And he, as the leadership, like, first year, this guy like, took the leadership role and just ran with it. He is absolutely amazing. And I think that Ja has that thing inside him. Like, I don't know what it is, but he has a thing inside him where I think he could be a great playoff performer. And I think, like, if they do maintain that 8 seed, I could see a big job performance like, in a game that they win or even just narrowly lose. And I think this is a good thing, like, facing, like, a veteran Lakers team. And I think this is going to be a great test for these young Grizzlies because they're going to be a great team moving forward. Next team we're going to be talking about is the Dallas Mavericks. And, you know, they obviously have Luka Doncic, a top five MVP candidate, 100%. You got Kristaps Porzingis, who, again, I mean, like, I just think, like, I mean, people say maybe he was still injured, maybe this rest is good for him, but I think he just had to kind of play his way back into shape, and this is kind of, I think this may set him back a bit. And, you know, the Mavs have a pretty solid-looking team, but the thing is, I just think, like, whoever they come up in the first round, like, I just don't think they're just experienced enough, whether it's the Nuggets, whether it's the Clippers, whether it's the Lakers. I just don't think they're going to be, like, the experience enough, and opposite of Morant, like, I just think that Luka may struggle in this, like, in this playoff series, And I just think like, it's going to be like one of those things where, you know, a lot of pundits are going to be kind of on Luka and saying like, oh, maybe he doesn't have what it takes because he doesn't perform in the playoffs. But he'll be able to bounce back. But I don't think this is like their year. But I can definitely see them like put up a good fight in the first round. The final team before we head into the break is the Philadelphia 76ers. And, you know, a lot of people have this team as an ultimate dark horse. I mean, this team has the talent in Ben Simmons, Joel Embiid, Al Horford, Tobias Harris, Josh Richardson. I can keep naming names. They have some talent on that team. And if you listen to this podcast before the season, I had this team going to the finals, going up against the Lakers. And I had Joel Embiid winning MVP. And as you can see from their production this season, they have not gone close to that. And I'm honestly really disappointed. Like, I just think that this team is going to like completely fold. Because the fact that they had to like change the starting lineup this late into the season, like that gives me no hope whatsoever, because like they're still trying to figure this things out. Like they've been trying to figure this out for years, and like midway through the season you're making these type of changes, it's tough, and they've made a lot of mistakes. And I think that if they especially get on in the first round this year, they're gonna need to make a lot of changes, and I'm gonna definitely talk about that when the offseason comes around. But yeah, they need to really fix some things up. And this is the first half of the list. I'm obviously leave your thoughts below what you thought so far. We're going to get to the second part of the list soon, but quickly let's get like one topic in, you know, from the NBA bubble before we get into that second half of the list. And then the one I'm going to talk about is the Bol Bol hype, because in one scrimmage game, the Denver Nuggets, I cannot remember exactly who to face. I think it was the Detroit Pistons. I believe it was the Detroit Pistons. And firstly, the Nuggets came out with this ridiculous lineup where they had Nikola Jokic at the point, Jeremy Grant at the two, who, mind you, stands at 6'9". They had Bol Bol, who hasn't played a game all year, coming in at the three position. They had Paul Millsap running the four, and they had Mason Plumlee at the five. And what I found crazy about this is that, you know, firstly, a lot of, like, if you play 2K like me, like, people know about the Pink Diamond Nikola Jokic glitch card, who could play point guard. And the fact that they did in real life, honestly, just made me smile for a bit. There's a great response by Daryl Morey, the general manager of the Houston Rockets, like, because, you know, the Rockets going small ball. This is kind of like the anti-Rockets here, and what the Denver Nuggets did. And he posted a picture of, I forgot that Jack Black movie, but it was him as a giant. Like, and I found that really funny. So that this, like, that whole line just became a meme for the day, which is great. But the talking point of that game was Bol Bol, who in his first game, I mean, obviously it's not an official regular season game, but he put up 16 points, 10 rebounds, and blocked six shots. Yes, six shots. And I know, like, a lot of people hasn't listened to this podcast probably since this quarantine. I think that's when more people started listening to it. But last year, when I made my mock draft, it wasn't like a full mock draft, but I did, like, just for the lottery teams, like who I thought could go where. I had Bol Bol as a top five just talent in this draft, but because of the injuries sustained at Oregon, I thought that he would maybe slip to the end of the lottery, just because I think a team like the Celtics, like, imagine having Bol Bol in the Celtics, just that big man presence, like, that would be so useful for them. And I had them taking him with the 14th pick, just because, you know, take a chance on this guy. This guy has probably all the talent in the world. I saw a comment, he's basically the Dark Porzingis, which I could definitely see. And I just like this whole skill set. I didn't know he could shoot threes like that, like the way he was, like, just pulling up from deep. But I just, like, he had the skill set. He had the handles. He could rebound. He could defend because he's just long. He's extremely long. And this guy slipped to, like, the mid of the second round. And kind of like how the Nuggets kind of, like, had Michael Porter Jr. the year before that slip right to them because of injuries. Same thing here with Bol Bol, who not only dropped out of the lottery, this guy dropped out of the whole first round and almost out of the entire draft. Like, I was honestly getting word that he wasn't going to get selected at all, but he finally did. And maybe he may not play this. He may or may not play this year. But what I could definitely say about Bol Bol is a lot of teams, especially if he, like, goes on this trajectory, a lot of teams are going to regret this, like, not taking him, because I think a lot of guys are high on him because of his build, the way that he is able to have all that skill at that height. But people were just so scared with big men and injuries and all that, that they didn't really, look to Bol Bol, like, especially in the draft. I just think, even, like I said, I think it would have been fair if he got chosen at the late lottery because of those injuries. But the fact he slipped all the way to, like, the 40s, like, absolutely baffles me. And I think a lot of teams are going to regret not selecting Bol Bol at that position. So, you know, I hope this guy does well. I hope he really does, because if looking at the Nuggets over the next 10 years, you have people like Jamal Murray, you have people like Nikola Jokic, then you have MPG, Michael Porter Jr., who, like they said, like, was the number one guy coming out of high school before he got, like, injured when he was playing. I can't think of it off the top of my head. I want to say Missouri. You guys can correct me if possible, but yeah, I just think they have a nice, like, team for the next decade. And if Bol Bol becomes anything close to what we expect him to be when he was at Oregon, this team is going to be scary and probably going to be, like, contenders in the West for a while. So, you know, that whole performance at Bol Bol, you know, kind of, like, gave me hope, because especially, like, I, like, kind of projected him to go high in the draft. But yeah, I just, like, can't wait to see. Hopefully he gets more play time, and I want him to be, honestly, a good contributor to that Denver Nuggets team down the line. I'll be talking about more of my Denver Nuggets expectations in a couple minutes, but I'm just glad to see Bol Bol doing well. Excuse me. And hopefully he can just get a nice role carved out for him in that team. Maybe not even that team. Maybe he'll raise his trade value and go to a team where he could be more used directly, because him and Jokic in the front court, maybe it'll work. We'll have to wait and see, but you know, I'm probably dropping the gun. I mean, it's one scrimmage game preseason, first game back before, I mean, after the whole quarantine, like maybe I'm extremely jumping the gun, but when I see like someone like him, who I, like I said, who I was kind of high on, do well, you just gotta go with that. So yeah, hopefully Bol Bol finds a role on that team and can be a good NBA player. We're going to go back into the final 11 teams here. I want to drink some water real quick because I'm going to need to talk a lot about this kind of nonstop. So some nice water over there. Let's get into the final 11 teams for the NBA bubble and kind of my expectations on them coming into the season. And we're going to start the timer again at 3, 2, 1, boom. And the first team we're going to be discussing is the Indiana Pacers. Yes, like, I think, like, my expectations on the Pacers this year all depend on whether Oladipo is playing or not, because they're a good team without Oladipo on the court, but I just don't think that translates to a good playoff team. Sure, they have a good point guard in Malcolm Brogdon and some two good centers, but with Jeremy Lamb being injured, that's because he tore his meniscus and ACL. That was a rough one. They don't have much scoring threats in the perimeter besides T.J. Warren and Brogdon. But when you have Oladipo on the court, I think that kind of like changes the whole perspective, like the whole outlook of the Pacers team. And I think they could shock some teams, even like a not 100% Oladipo. I think he changes the game that much for them. And where do I think I'm going to go? Potential going through the first round, but if Oladipo's not 100%, like, I still think maybe they might not even make it out the first round, but it all really depends on him. We go on to the next team, which is the Houston Rockets, and my expectations for the Rockets are similar to Philly, and, you know, because if they have all the pieces staying together at some point, I really think that they could make some noise. But the thing is, with the whole COVID situation, like, not having Westbrook there in time, Harden coming in late, and the fact that I think they needed those like last 18 games or so to kind of like figure out like what, like how good and how far they can go with this small ball lineup. And I just think that in 8 games, especially coming off a quarantine, I don't think it'll do much good for them. They made a lot of trades at the trade deadline to kind of like make this team work. And, you know, the stoppage and play just didn't help these guys. And especially with like, you know, Westbrook, like we know the playoff history of Harden. We know the playoff history of Westbrook. Like, it hasn't been pretty for them whatsoever. And, you know, it's one of those things where I'll believe it when I see it. And again, with the whole quarantine and the whole stoppage of play, I don't think the Rockets got any favors here. I don't think they'll do much work. A team that I'm going to talk about now, I think will put in a good shift, and that is the Oklahoma City Thunder. And honestly, West teams, they should be scared of this team. Not that in the fact that they're going to maybe eliminate like some of the top guys, but they're going to give you a scare for 100%, especially like with Chris Paul running the point. If you let your guard down, they're going to pounce. And I think, you know, with CP3 running the show there in Oklahoma City, and like the way the roster's constructed, they really caught a lot of teams off guard this year. And that really worked in their favor because they have a really well-constructed roster. Great center in Steven Adams, some great perimeter shooting with Danilo Gallinari, some great defense in Lou Dort, and then a great guard rotation with Shea and also Dennis Schroeder coming off the bench. Like, I just think this team, if they make it to the second round, could put a scare into the Clippers or Lakers. So even though like they might not have the talent of the Houston, I think that they are a more cohesive unit. So that is the Thunder right there. Move on to the next team. We're going to be talking about the Miami Heat. Yes, we had Ethan on the podcast on Wednesday, and we talked quite a bit of Heat, but I'll still talk about them here. I just think they're an experienced team because, like, you know, they have a lot of young guys, not a lot of playoff experience, but they have Jimmy Butler, who has plenty of that. And if there's one thing you're going to always expect with the Heat, is they're going to put up a big fight. You have a lot of guys that are great hustlers. You have just good, you know, just a nice mix of players. But I just don't think that, you know, with their lack of experience, especially with Kendrick Nunn running the point, Tyler Hero as a rookie, Duncan Robinson, Bam Adebayo, like, having a prominent role now. And I think, you know, speaking of Bam, I think he is like the make or break for the team. Jimmy Butler is going to perform in the playoffs. I'm already like certain of that. But if Bam continues his production from like this season, I think that maybe they could make some noise and really put a scare into teams, kind of like the Thunder do. But that's really going to depend. And Bama's number two option going to the playoffs for the first time. We have to see how that goes. Next thing we're going to be talking about is the Utah Jazz. Yes, Team COVID, as a lot of fans want to think them as. I mean, like, what's rough about the Utah Jazz is that, you know, Mike Conley has been injured all year. I don't know, like, how stable his condition is right now. And with Bogdanovich, one of their, like, key perimeter threats, not even going to be, like, playing. I find it really hard for them to make it out the first round. I still think they're going to be able to create enough offense. And Mitchell will probably do his thing, but I just don't think there's enough perimeter threats, especially Bogey was so important to them. And I just think it's been such a chaotic season for the Jazz that, like, I don't, like, especially with, like, you know, trying to insert Mike Conley in the lineup, which has honestly hasn't been that great. And with the whole COVID situation, like, the tension between Mitchell and Gobert in the beginning of quarantine, like, I think it's a lot of things that they have to, like, just kind of, like, ignore to kind of, like, turn this around. I just don't think they'll be able to. Next team we're going to be talking about is the Denver Nuggets. Again, I talked about them in the Bol Bol situation, but I'll talk about what I expect from them in the season. I don't think they're going to put out that big that big man lineup going to the playoffs. But, you know, I mean, it's like one of those things. Like last year, they got eliminated by the Portland Trail Blazers in the second round. I don't see them getting much further than that just because of the guys at the top. I mean, the Clippers and the Lakers just feel like they're going to automatically just be at that top position, like, already. And, you know, they have a talented team. But, you know, these guys just need to continue to, like, go through these, like, early struggles in the playoffs, like Jokic, MPJ, you know, Gary Harris, who has completely fallen off on the map, by the way, Jamal Murray. I just think that these guys have to continue going through the struggles, and once they, like, kind of, like, figure out a winning formula, I think they're going to make some noise. But I just don't think this is the year. Like I said, second round at best, but I don't see them dethroning either the Lakers or the Clippers. We move back to the East for this next one. We're going to be talking about the Boston Celtics, and I find them the most interesting team in the East because they have what you like, what all teams want in a deep playoff team. They have shot makers. Jaylen Brown, Jason Tatum, Kemba Walker, Gordon Hayward. These guys can hit shots, and I think that these guys can hit shots, like, late in games, like when it gets really tough. I mean, like I said all season, if you've been listening to this podcast, that center position always is a threat, is always worrisome to me. But having those guys as, like, just shot makers, like, and a lot of teams don't even have that one guy. These guys have four. And I think that, you know, they have some great defenders on their team as well. Like, I think that they have a shot at the Eastern Conference Finals. And if things go right for them, if all the pieces fall into place, could make a finals appearance. Maybe I'm crazy, but honestly, I believe that with these guys and their perimeter guys, they could do it. We're going to be going on to the final three teams now. And the first one we're going to be talking about is the LA Clippers. And, you know, with their whole cast healthy, you know, they have to be one of the top teams to be, you know, making some noise in the playoffs. Kawhi and PG in the playoffs. Well, I mean, they've only played, I think, so little games together, especially as a full roster. I think it's, as a full roster, they've only played six games, if I remember correctly. And, you know, like, if the team is, like, played as good as they look on paper, that's scary. That is just scary. And but the only concern I have is, like I said, they only played, like, very few games together. I don't know, like how well they're going to, like, kind of, like, work things out because they haven't played, like, a full season together. But I just think because they have a great coach, they have professionals, they have, like, a good, like, veteran roster as well. I just think they have to have a deep run. But even still, I consider them a top team. I wouldn't put them in the finals still. I still have another team ahead of them. We move on to the final East team, and I'm going to be talking about my Toronto Raptors. And from what I've been seeing on Instagram and Twitter, people are high on this team. In Vegas, I know that they had, like, the fifth or sixth odds in the finals, which makes them a very, like, you know, juicy, you know, pick to make the finals because, like, you don't have to bet as much, and you can, like, make a big time if they actually do pull it off. I mean, they're a great, lovable team, and honestly, as a cohesive unit, they can cause problems to anyone in the league. Nick Nurse will throw stuff out that, honestly, that we have never seen before, and I think that will, like, throw a lot of these teams off guard. But my only concern with my team is that Siakam's number one guy. How is he going to react in the playoffs? Because when he faces top teams this year, he just doesn't, like, he kind of shrivels up, and it's going to be hard, like, as a cohesive unit to do it well for that many games. So you know, the experience of number one guy, I think, is going to hold the Raptors back, and maybe we don't make the Eastern Conference Finals. There's actually one more East team we're going to be talking about later, but next team we're going to be talking about is the Los Angeles Lakers, and it's just, in my gut, it feels like this is their year. They have two of the top five players in the league, probably two of the top five MVP candidates in the league, and, you know, the playoffs, you know, when it's playoff time, your stars show up. And who bigger of a star than Mr. LeBron James? LeBron James, before last season, made it to eight straight finals. And I think, like, with Anthony Davis there, just gives them, like, an extra, like, you know, a superstar-type player. I mean, sure, they're missing Rondo. They're missing Avery Bradley. But I just feel like with this team, you have LeBron, you have AD, that's enough. That's more than enough. You have, and they have some good role players as well. You know, Caruso, Howard, McGee. I think they have a good enough team, and I think, again, this just feels like it's going to be their year. And the final team we're going to be discussing on this list is the Milwaukee Bucks, and I think that this team just does not get enough credit for how good they are. They're historically great, and no one really talks about it. Like, I read in like an article just a few days ago. The Bucks have the fourth best defense in NBA history. Like people don't understand like how great these guys are. And talking about like my Giannis argument from last episode or two episodes ago, this guy only plays like 32 minutes a game, and this guy is putting up those type of numbers just because the Bucks absolutely trash teams, and they just like they're able to set their stars out the way in games. I mean, I just feel like, you know, the way that the Bucks are, it's just such a good unit. And having that guy in Giannis, I think they'll make the finals. And, you know, honestly, if they win the championship, Giannis' legacy will go into a whole new stratosphere. Will be mentioned among the all-time greats, especially if he wins MVP as well. And boom, that is the 11 minutes gone. Oh, man, that's a lot of talking. You know, try to keep it short and concise. Tell me if you like this type of idea. Maybe I went too fast, but, you know, try to keep things short and concise, and I was able to get through all the teams. Whew, let's let me take one swig of water because, man, that's a lot of teams to talk about. But like I said, you know, NBA is coming back in 6 days. I'm extremely excited for it to come back. My Raptors are finally going to be having their first scrimmage game against the Houston Rockets tonight, so that's going to be extremely exciting to watch, seeing the boys back on the court. And, yeah, coming out of this, just like if you're listening to this episode, leave in the comment section of this YouTube, leave in the comment section of my Instagram, who do you think is going to win the NBA championship this year? There's a lot of factors because if it's like in this whole bubble and stuff, but who do you think is going to be coming out as the championship, the champion this year? And I think this is where we're going to end it. Thank you guys for listening. Remember to follow all my social media platforms at TV on Basketball. My link tree is in my channel, so please go check that out. I'll also have it linked in the description. Remember, all my member podcast listeners, Anchor, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Podbean, you can find me all on those four platforms. And if you're watching this and seeing my beautiful face on YouTube, remember to please like, share, and subscribe for more of this type of content. I may be posting different videos besides podcasts here. Maybe some reaction videos to some articles and stuff. Maybe just reacting to some NBA plays. Who knows? But I think I could do some stuff with this YouTube channel, and hopefully I can put up some extra content here for sure. And remember, I'm going to have one episode a week put on my IGTV as well from the podcast. But I think this is where we're going to end it. Thank you guys for listening. Hope you all have a fantastic weekend. I'll see you back here on Monday. Have a good one, guys.